Morning students. Well, in the last class we had been till how we separate mixture of salt and camphor. That I think was over. So now even now is the dye in black ink for single color. That is also over, fine. So now we'll be seeing how to separate a mixture of two miscible liquids. So how to separate mixture of two miscible liquids. So how is this two liquids which have mixed? Actually we saw water and kerosene, that was different, that was immiscible liquid. But here we have miscible liquids, means which are going to mix. So that is about acetone and water. Assume that we have a mixture of acetone and water. So to do this experiment, what else is required? First, we want thermometer. Then distillation flask. Water condenser. Clamp stand. Then what else? We require Bunsen burner. Beaker. And there are still others. But now we'll be seeing clamp stand, and for this this is a distillation flask, and this is the Bunsen burner. And down this flask, what we will do, we will keep one thermometer. Then what we'll do, we'll take one water condenser. So this is how we have to set up the apparatus, right? So here, this is the mixture of acetone and water, right? This is a mixture of acetone and water. We should remember, there is difference of 25 Kelvin temperature between these two. Means acetone should have different boiling temperature, and also water should have different boiling temperature. Actually, the mixed miscible liquids should be having difference of 25 Kelvin in their boiling point, right? So we'll start heating it with the Bunsen burner, and the one which is having low boiling point, it starts evaporating, and then it starts moving into this condenser, and then it cools and comes and falls in this beaker. Fine. So So as we keep heating the mixture, which is having low boiling point, it starts evaporating sooner. Then it starts evaporating sooner, and then as it evaporates here, it starts moving through this condenser, water condenser, right? Through that condenser, it gets condensed, it gets cold. This evaporation water droplets starts becoming as it feels cold, those water droplets start moving into this, and it settles in this beaker. So here, this is the acetone which is separated, and the water is left in the distillation flask itself. It means water is having high boiling point compared to acetone. So while doing this process, the two mixtures should have two different boiling points, and that too they should have a difference of minimum 25 Kelvin. So is this clear? So this process is called as distillation. This process is called as distillation. Alright. Is this understood? Fine. So this was only for the boiling temperature, boiling point, where the temperature is above 25 Kelvin. Means they should have minimum 25 Kelvin difference in their boiling points. Now there are few liquids which are mixed and they are having their boiling points less than 25 Kelvin. So they are having their boiling points less than 25 Kelvin. At this moment, what we have to do, how we have to separate it? At this moment, what we will do is, we will use fractional distillation. Fractional distillation. Alright? Where it was 25 Kelvin and above, there we use only distillation. And where there is less than 25 Kelvin difference, then we have to use the fractional distillation. The process is going to be same, the apparatus are also going to be same, but what we are doing here is we are taking one another apparatus, that is fractionating column, that we will be adding just above the distillation flask. Means distillation flask, then we will have fractionating column. To this column this condenser is added. The process remains the same. For example, to separate different gases from air, for that we use this fractionating column, and then to petroleum products, there also to separate we use this fractionating column. Fine. So actually, here what this fractionating column is doing is, it is having beds in it. They are having small beds. The use of the small beds is, it gives surface and it allows to cool down and then move through that condenser. That is why fractionating column is used, as it is having small beds in it. Right? So next, it is how can we obtain different gases? So how to obtain different gases from air? First we will take air, then it is compressed with high pressure and low temperature. It is compressed with high pressure and low temperature. So as the pressure is increasing, the temperature is decreasing. So as we start increasing the pressure, the temperature is decreasing there. So that we get we are going to get liquid air. Once we get this liquid air, we have to allow it to warm. We have to allow it to warm in fractionating column. In fractionating column. Fractionating column means it is fractional distillations column, right? So then, depending upon boiling points, and heights, the gases get separated from the air. So in case if oxygen is having -183°C, in case if oxygen is having -183°C, then at that point of temperature the oxygen gets separated. And then we have argon. It is going to get separated at -186°C. So depending upon their boiling points and heights, those gases are getting separated from the air. Right? So how it goes? They are given the diagram there. Just go through it. Then there is another activity where you can see how can we obtain pure copper sulfate from an impure sample. That is because of crystallization. Read it, right? So directly now we'll be moving to physical and chemical changes. Physical and chemical changes. Physical change. And we have a chemical change. So first we should understand what is physical change and chemical change. The change which takes only through physical appearance. A change which takes only through physical appearance, that is said to be physical change. For example, we'll cut a piece of paper. Assume we are having a paper and we'll cut it or we'll tear it. Then after tearing also, it is not losing its property. Paper remains as same as the earlier paper, but only the problem there is the size has been reduced. Alright. So in physical change, there is no new substances formed. No new substance is formed. Where? In physical change. Then coming to chemical change. I think you all might be aware of cooking food, right? So once we cook the food, we cannot get back the raw materials which we have used there. For example, assume you have prepared tea, where you had used water, sugar, tea powder and milk to prepare tea. So initially you had 4 ingredients for tea, but once it went under the chemical change, there we did not get back those raw materials which we had used earlier. While burning of candle, think there is a candle and you are burning that candle. Once the power goes off in the home, we start lighting the candles, right? When we light the candle is undergoing a chemical change because it is giving out light or heat to you. Apart from giving out light and heat, it is emitting carbon dioxide into the environment. So actually it was only made up of wax and a thread, but now after we burn it, there is some residue left behind after burning. So that states there is a new substance formed in chemical change. Right? New substance is formed in chemical change. Understood? Then this physical change is going to be always a temporary. If we tear the paper, we can paste it and we'll get back the same paper, right? But once we prepare the tea, we cannot get back the sugar and milk from it, right? Therefore, physical change is a temporary change. It is a temporary change. The change here is temporary, whereas here the change is permanent. The change is permanent, right? Then this physical change is reversible in nature, whereas chemical change is not reversible. Physical change is a reversible change, whereas chemical change is irreversible change. So physical change is a reversible change, whereas this chemical change is irreversible. Reversible and irreversible means, actually reversible means what? We have to get back the same item which was there. For example, we have torn the paper, right? Once we joint it, we are going to get back the paper itself. Even after tearing that paper, it remained as paper. So that is reversible. Whereas cooking especially is irreversible, because we cannot get back how it was initially. For example, using rice and all, we are going to cook it, right, with vegetables and all. But after cooking, if we ask the vegetables to be the same as before cutting the vegetables, and that cooked rice before as it was like raw rice, we cannot get that. That is why that is a irreversible change. Burning is always a chemical change, remember it, because it is giving out carbon dioxide. There new substance is formed. That is why that chemical change is irreversible and this physical change is reversible. Then this physical change is giving out very little heat. Very little heat or light energy. Heat energy or light energy is given out, or it is absorbed here in physical change. Whereas in chemical change, lots of heat or light energy is given out or it is absorbed. Then the last one, mass of substance does not alter here in physical change. Mass of substance does not alter in physical change. Because even after breaking a brick, it's going to be the same mass. But whereas in chemical change, the mass of substance does alter. Remember, mass of substance does alter in a chemical change. Means mass of the substance is going to play a vital role in physical change as well as in chemical change. Especially in physical change, actually it has nothing to do there. But in chemical change, mass of the substance is going to play a vital role. That is why mass of the substance is, mass of substance does alter in a chemical change. Therefore, in chemical change, mass of the substance is going to be changed once it goes under chemical change. Whereas in physical change, even though if it goes under a physical change, mass of that is not going to alter. So this is about physical change and chemical change. Alright? You can just give a pause and you can write it. So next we will be continuing with elements. Elements, first it was given, the word element was given by a scientist called Robert Boyle. What is that? Robert Boyle. He is the scientist first who gave the word called element. He gave this term element in 1661. So remember, in 1661 only, this Robert Boyle coined this term as elements. Then later, Antoine Lavoisier, the French scientist, what he did, by experimenting, he gave the definition of this element. He gave definition to this element. So what is element according to Antoine Lavoisier? Actually, by doing experiment, he gave it and that is useful. So the definition of element is a basic form of matter which cannot be broken into its simpler forms. So a basic form of matter that cannot be broken into its simpler forms. So even with the help of chemical reaction, that element is a form of matter which cannot be broken into simpler forms even by using chemical reactions. That is said to be an element. So understood, element means it cannot be further broken down into its simpler forms even with the help of chemical reaction. Then here in elements, we have three categories. One is metals, the other one is non-metals, and the third one is metalloids. So we have these three groups under this elements, that is metals, non-metals and metalloids. The spelling is wrong here. It's E, not E.
Alright.
Metalloids. So metals, coming back to first one, metals. So what are the properties of these metals? Why do we call them as metals? Because of what kind of property we call them as metals? That we'll be seeing here. Metals have luster in them.
Have luster.
What is luster? It is shininess. For example, silver. It is when we make a silver color, that silver color is going to attract us because it is shining in nature. Iron, that is also shining. So almost all metals have luster of their own. They have shining surface on it, all the metals.
Then it conducts heat and electricity.
So metals are going to conduct heat and electricity through them. So if heat is passed to that metal, that entire metal is going to have heat in it. Like how we don't touch the hot pans. Why? Pan is also a metal, right? Or in simple words, cooker, which we all use in our daily life. When the cooker is hot, we don't touch it. Why? Because that cooker is conducting heat in it, right? In case if there is any metal and if there is current passing to it, we don't touch it. So all metals conduct heat and electricity.
Then they are malleable. Malleable and ductility.
We call it as malleability and ductility. Malleability means using that metal, what we are doing? We are making thin sheets out of it by heating it. So using that metal, we are making thin sheets. That is malleable property. Whereas this ductile property is,
we are getting wires out of it.
They can be stranded to thin wires. For example, all the wires of this electricity poles, that is ductility of property. Because whatever the metal is used, that has been hammered and it has been brought into the shape of wires. That is ductility. Then this malleability is making it or drying it into thin sheets. So sheets is malleability, whereas this wires is ductility. Understood?
And then metals are sonorous in nature.
Metals are sonorous in nature means
it is giving out sound whenever you hit the metal.
It is giving out some sound, it is producing some sound. That is why it is known as sonorous.
And these have silvery gray or
golden yellow. So understood? So these are the properties of metals. Metals have luster, that is they have the shininess. Then they conduct heat and electricity, means heat is also conducted by the metal, whereas electricity is also conducted by the metal. Then it can be brought to malleable. So metals are malleable. Malleable means they can be drawn into thin sheets, and they are also having ductile property, that is ductility. So they can be hammered and brought into the wire shape. Then metals are sonorous in nature, means they are producing sound whenever they are hit. And at last, they have silvery gray or golden yellow color on them. So this is about property of metals. So till now, we have studied distillation, fractional distillation, and separating the gases from air using fractional distillation also, right? Then coming back to elements, then physical change, chemical change, and the elements. And in elements, we have three categories: metals, non-metals, and metalloids. Now we have been completed with metals. Example for this metals are simple:
iron, gold, silver. Right.
So these are examples for metals. So this completes today's class, and in the next class we'll be continuing with next one. So in the homework for today,
write differences between physical and chemical change. And then second one, mention the properties of metals. Mention the properties of metals. So this is the homework that you have to do.
So whatever is taught, please do read carefully with the help of textbook. And as I keep saying again and again, read textbook daily. Keep reading the textbook daily so that it helps you. So stay home, stay safe, see you in the next class. Thank you.